Jesus said in John 12:32, "And if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto me." And also in Acts the 4th chapter, verse 12, "Neither is there salvation in any other, for there's no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved." Praise God. Well, praise God. I'm Brother Rich, and this is Mail Call. Praise God. We're coming to you live on Virtual Ark Joy Fellowship Men's Ministry. Praise God. Hallelujah. Well, praise God. I'm going to be having a pastor, praise God, Youngblood, reading out of the Old Testament. Praise God. And that's going to be Psalm 133. And I will go ahead and open in prayer. Pastor Youngblood.
Amen. Amen. God bless everybody tonight. And we're going to be coming to you from Psalms 133, verses 3, starting with verses 3. And as a duo of Herman.
Begin with verse 1.
Verse 1. I'm sorry. That is my fault. Let me go back. All right. I had to freeze it. There we go. All right. Here we go. All right. Praise God. A song of degrees of David. Hold, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. Verse 2 says, "It is like the precious ointments upon the head that ran down upon the beard, even Aaron's beard, that went down to the skirts of his garment." Verses 3. "And as the dew of Hermon, and as the dew that descended upon the mountains of Zion, for there the Lord commanded the blessings, even life forevermore." God bless.
Thank you so much, Pastor Youngblood. Praise God. Let us all go before the Lord. The great God that formed all things, the creator of the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that therein is. Father God, as we come before you right now, Lord God, as your servants, as your children, we pray, Father God, for you to forgive us for anything we've said or done to have offended you in any kind of way. Forgive us, Lord, for dwelling on thoughts contrary to your word, contrary to your will, contrary to your way. Forgive us for presumptuous sins, O God, in the name of Jesus. Father, forgive us, Lord God. Lord, cleanse us, O God, from all filthiness of the flesh and of the spirit. And Father, we thank you, Lord God. Hallelujah, that this is National Prayer Day. And truly, we humble ourselves before you.
Hallelujah.
Lord God, as we bring these petitions and as your children bring these petitions before you, we thank you, Father God, that you are answering. You will answer these petitions on this day of prayer. In Jesus' name, have your way on Mail Call, Lord God. Bless those that are coming on tonight, Lord God, that are coming on to hear. Bless them to hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying unto them in this hour. And Father, we'll be careful to give you all the praise, the honor, and the glory that thou art so worthy of. Praise God. Well, dearly beloved, God has given us free course and a window of time, praise God, to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, before he returns. It is critical that we be about our Father's business. Even Jesus said, "I must be about my Father's business while it is day. The night cometh when no man can work." We feel a sense of urgency as never before, praise God, by the Holy Spirit, to rise above complacency by being bold as a lion and taking back that which the enemy has stolen, that which the pommel worm and the canker worm and the locust has stolen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Well, praise God. Mail call reflects on the following scriptures. Matthew, the 28th chapter, verses 18 through 20. That's Matthew, the 28th chapter, verses 18 through 20, known as the Great Commission. And also Ephesians, the 4th chapter, verses 8 through 13. Ephesians, the 4th chapter, verses 8 through 13, known as the fivefold ministry. Praise God. Give me just a second while I enlarge this. I can praise God. There we go. All right. Praise God. I'm going to be reading from Matthew, the 28th chapter, verse 18 in the New Testament. And Jesus came and spake unto him, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. And I'm also going to read the NLT. Jesus came and told his disciples, I have been given all authority in heaven and on earth. Praise God. That is known as the Great Commission. Praise God. Oh, give me 28:20, Pastor. Praise God. From the King James Version, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen. And out of the NLT, teach these new disciples to obey all the commands I have given you. And be sure of this, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Praise God. That is known. 28th chapter, verses 18 through 20 in Matthew in the New Testament. Praise God. Hallelujah. As the Great Commission. And also, we're going to Ephesians, the 4th chapter, verses 8 through 13. That's Ephesians, the 4th chapter, verse 8 through 13. Coming out of the King James Version, out of the New Testament. Wherefore he saith, when he ascended up on high, he led captivity captive and gave gifts unto men. Praise God. And also in the NLT, that is why the scriptures say, when he ascended to the heights, he led a crowd of captives and gave gifts to his people. Praise God. Ephesians, the 4th chapter, verse 9. Now that he ascended, what is it but that he also descended first into the lower parts of the earth? And out of the NLT, notice that it says he ascended. This clearly means that Christ also descended to our lowly world. Verse 10, he that descended is the same also that ascended up far above all heavens, that he might fill all things. And out of the NLT, and the same one who descended is the one who ascended higher than all the heavens, so that he might fill the entire universe with himself. And in Ephesians, the 4th chapter, verse 11, and he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers. Now, these are the gifts Christ gave to the church: the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, and the pastors and teachers. Ephesians 4:12, for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. And from the NLT, their responsibility is to equip God's people to do his work and build up the church, the body of Christ. And in Ephesians, the 4th chapter, verse 13, out of the King James Version, till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Praise God. And out of the NLT, this will continue until we all come to such unity in our faith and knowledge of God's Son that we will be mature in the Lord, measuring up to the full and complete standard of Christ. And in Ephesians, the 4th chapter, verse 13, coming out of the New Testament, till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. And coming out of the NLT, this will continue until we all come to such unity in our faith and knowledge of God's Son that we will be mature in the Lord, measuring up to the full and complete standard of Christ. Oh, hallelujah. Lord, we thank you, Lord God. We ask that you hasten your word to perform it, Lord God, throughout this world. Oh,
can you see me?
Because you said in your word,
can you hear
so
me?
So shall my word be. Yes,
yes, yes, yes, yes.
So
yes.
Shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth.
Can you hear me?
It shall not return unto me void.
Okay.
But it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper whereunto I send it. So, Lord, we thank you, Lord God, that you will hasten your word to perform it in the mighty name of Jesus. And praise God. We thank God for my co-host, hallelujah, being able to be on. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Well, you know, it's that time again. It's that time again. Praise God. You know, we always have an attitude for gratitude moment. And before I bring on my co-host with the teaching tonight, praise, I am the way, the truth, and the life. We're going to do things a little bit different. We will give thanks to the Lord right now. And, you know, because in everything, give thanks. This is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. But because this is National Prayer Day, we are going to take this time to come before our Father in heaven, Abba Daddy, praise God, and bring these petitions unto the Lord. Lord God, whatever is on our heart to pray, we will pray individually, and we will stand in agreement according to Matthew 18, 19, and 20, that if two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything that they shall ask, it shall be done for them of my Father which is in heaven. For where two or more are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them. And you are in the midst of your people all over this nation in this hour. And we thank you, Lord God, for your angels encamped around about your children, your children's children. Praise God, as we come before your throne room, because we are made to sit in heavenly places. So praise God. At this time, you know, the word of God says they overcame him. They overcame who? They overcame the dragon. They overcame Lucifer. They overcame Satan by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. And they loved not their life unto the death. So at this time, come forth in the mighty name of Jesus to give God the praise, to give God the honor, and to give God the glory.
Well, I always like to say thank God that He's the God that he is. He's the God that he is. And I thank God for my life. I thank God for everything that he's doing, that he's done, that he's going to do. And, you know, in this world, and this, I talk about this a lot, about the chaotic, events that happen in the world. I'm sitting there looking at TV today and seeing a wild, you know, pursuit somewhere in Arizona where they had to use a grappling hook equipment on this car, and they were shooting rubber bullets. Once they got the car stopped and everything, They were shooting rubber bullets into the car and trying to get this guy out and everything. And it's just the world is just and it's not surprising, it's not alarming anymore. It's actually kind of numbing now, because when you do turn on the TV and you see these things, how things, you know, how the events unfold, you know, all you can just say is that I hope, you know, that person comes out alive. I hope nobody else gets hurt, and that, you know, they can come to a reasonable resolve, you know, and apprehend people. But we got so many people dying at the hands of the police, and you got so many police dying at the hands of, you know, criminals. And so there's got to be some kind of peace, you know, that, and, you know, that's what I pray for today. When we're talking about the National Prayer Day today, I pray for peace in the world. You know, I pray for peace in my home. I pray for peace in this world. I pray for peace all over the nation, all in the Capitol, all up in the White House, everywhere that, you know, that we think about the chaotic situation when we turn on the news. You know, that, you know, people can be saved. People can understand that it don't take all that, you know, to have a joyful life. You know, we can do things peacefully, and we can do things, you know, godly and Christianly, you know, so that, you know, everybody gets a chance to survive and live and do that. On the other flip side of it, I just thank God for just continue blessing me, continue, you know, keeping my health. Sometimes I don't feel, you know, all up to speed on a whole lot of things. You know, feel like my energy loss is just, you know, kind of low. But I give God glory in all of it, whether I feel tired or whether I feel energized or if I'm in between, you know. I just thank Him for all of the storms. I thank Him for the good times and the bad times. And we got it. That's how we praise God. That's how we don't just praise Him in the good time. We praise Him in the bad time. You know, because if we didn't know the bad, we wouldn't even know how to praise Him in the good time. You know, so I just thank God tonight, and that's pretty much my testimony.
Well, we thank God for that testimony. To God be the glory. Something. Go right ahead,
my
brother.
Can I say something?
Absolutely.
You know, I'm kind of piggybacking off of Pastor Youngblood with, you know, world peace, I guess. You know, that's sort of the usual thing that a Miss America pageant would say, you know, I want world peace, you know, because it sounds good on their resume, I guess. But, you know, peace and revival, you know, being that we're in our end of days, you know, people are walking away from God. People are mocking Him. People are selling their souls to the devil and stuff. Mm-hmm. And the fact of the matter is they don't understand what they are literally doing with their eternal life. And I just pray that the Spirit of God, which God promised that He would pour out His Spirit in the end of days, that a lot of these people get the gist of what they need to do, because I can't even imagine that. But I know that for me, you know, God says, you know, to minister the message of the cross and to try to win as many souls as you can for Christ. He said it wasn't going to be easy, not going to be smooth, but we do it in that sense. And that's where you're going to hear God when you get up to heaven, you know, well done, my good and faithful servant, like that. Because then He'll ask you, what did you do with my son? What did you do with the life I gave you? And I want to make sure that when he asks me those questions, that I'm rooted and grounded in what I need to say that's coming from my heart. So that's what I wanted to say.
Amen. Praise God. Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. Well, praise God. We're going to do something a little bit different, as I said before. Well, I praise God. I want to share with you a testimony. Praise God. We have been gathering together every day at a certain time, praise God, with our church in prayer. Praise God. Praying, you know, praying for the nation, praying for the government, praying for the leaders, praying for even our own city, praise God, and the council and so forth and so on. Praise God for the mayor, for the police. Praise God. Hallelujah. And I'm telling you, God's presence has filled the prayer line as never before. And it seems like it's just getting better and better and better and better. So right now, praise God, as the Lord leads, each one of us is going to come before the Lord in prayer concerning this nation. In the name of Jesus, and whatever the Lord lays on your heart to pray, you go ahead and pray. And right now, praise God, we thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. That you are the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. And whoever liveth to make intercession for us. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for the ultimate price that you paid on Calvary for our sins. And we thank you that you were raised from the dead. Glory to God.
Thank you, Jesus.
And death had no dominion over you, because you took back the keys of death and hell.
Amen.
From Satan in the name of Jesus. You took it back, Lord. And we thank you. We Hallelujah. Thank you for that. In Jesus' name, we thank you for the Holy Spirit that came to reprove the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment, of sin because they believe not on me, of yes. righteousness because I go unto the Father and they see me no more, of judgment because the prince of this world is judged, and for this cause was the Son of Elohim made manifest, that he might destroy the works of HaSatan, that he might destroy the works of Satan, that he might destroy the works of Lucifer, that he might destroy the works of the dragon, that he might destroy Beelzebub, the Lord of Flies. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Holy Spirit, we yield our spirit to you in this hour. Have your way on mail call. Have your way with these prayers in Jesus' name. And anything that's not like you, Lord, anything that would try to hinder, oh God, that we're trying to stop this broadcast, we plead the blood of Jesus against you.
Yes.
We plead the blood of Jesus against you, and we take authority over you. We take authority over the Leviathan spirit. We take authority over the spirit of witchcraft. We take authority over the spirit of rejection. We take authority over the spirit of shame. We take authority over the spirit of doubt and unbelief. In the name of Jesus, we take authority in the name of Jesus over the wolf spirit. In the name of Jesus, we take authority over the spirit of witchcraft. In the name of Jesus, hallelujah. And we command you to bow down in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, and go back to the abyss where you belong.
Yes.
Go back to the abyss where you belong. You are not welcome here. You are not welcome. We are temples of the living God. And as God has said, I will in them and will be with, and I will be their God, and you shall be my sons and daughters. Wherefore, come out from among them and be ye separate, saith the Lord. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Have your way with these prayers in Jesus' name.
Yes, Lord. Well, God, I thank you, God, tonight. I thank you again, Lord. Can't say it enough. I thank God for your presence. I thank you for your blessings. I thank you for your deliverance. I thank you for everything you've done for us, Lord, and everything you're going to do for us. God, you said the prayers of the righteous availeth much. Lord, I believe that these are righteous men on this line tonight, and those who are listening, if there's righteous men on the line tonight praying, looking onto the broadcast, Lord, we pray that you hear our prayers, Lord. We pray that you receive our prayers, Lord, and that you would grant the desires of our heart, Lord, and that we cry out for our nation tonight. We cry out for our president tonight.
Yes, Lord.
We cry out for Ukrainian president tonight, Lord.
Yes,
we cry
Lord.
Out for all the presidents of all the worlds, even Putin himself.
Yes,
we cry
Lord.
Out for him, Lord, that you would go in and touch his heart and change his mind, change his heart, change his mind. You did it with Pharaoh and hardening Pharaoh's heart. Now you could do anything but fail. And I know that you can unharden someone's heart, Lord. So So, Lord, we need you to just step up, show up, and show out, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
We know
yes,
that
Lord.
You can do it.
Yes,
and
Lord.
God, you said in your word that if we come asking humbly and boldly, that you would be gracious enough to consider our request, Lord, and that we can have it, Lord. Now, Lord, we also just thank you for doing what you're doing because, Lord, there's a lot of stuff out there that you don't see that's happening in the world that's good. And, Lord, we need to see more of that, Lord, to encourage yes, somebody to do just as we do here on this broadcast on Virtual Art Channel and Mail Call platform, Lord, that we're out trying to encourage the world and inspire the world that you can live holy, that you can live godly, that you can have a Christian life without being a humbug type of a person. Because there's fun in serving you, Lord. There's desirable yes, things that we can do without drinking and smoking and
yes,
sexual orientational things and all of this immorality that goes on as it did in Sodom and Gomorrah. And Lord, we just know that if we can come and ask and boldly and come to you at the throne of glory, that you would go ahead and grant these requests, Lord. Lord, and just continue to bless us. Continue to put your hedge of protection around us, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Continue to be the strong tower in our lives, Lord, that we can call out to you, Lord, and that we can lay hands on the sick and they should recover, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
That we can even raise the dead at some point, Lord. You said that, don't marvel. You said when you left here, before you left here, don't marvel. You told the disciples, don't marvel at the things that I do now. You would do far greater things after I'm gone. And Lord, we're looking to do that. We're looking to access that power. We're looking to access all of what you've given us, the giftings and all the blessings and all the powers you've given us, and to tap into that those powers and learn how to yield those giftings and powers so that we can be those disciples of old, of yesterday, Lord, and be the modern disciples of today, that the people need those same events to happen again, that they can see signs and wonders and miracles, and that they know that they can believe upon you. And not just because they see signs, wonders, and miracles, but they truly believe in what you do, Lord, and what you say. And that when you establish and you say something, and you say it's well done, and it's done, and it's factual, that they can believe it, walk on faith, and just walk in it, Lord. And
so, yes, Lord. Yes,
we just thank you again, Lord, in advance, Lord. Bless your servants here on this platform tonight, Lord. And we'll be so careful to give you praise, honor, the glory. In your Son Christ Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Yes, Lord. Amen.
Thank you. Yes, Heavenly Father, Lord, I want to get specific here, Father. I would ask, Father, that you would bring back the hedge of protection on America, Father.
Yes, Lord.
Lord, that you would motivate the people, Father, to the hearts of the people, Father, and through your hearts of your people, Father, and through spiritual warfare, Lord, that we kick in the gates of hell through your Son, our Lord, and our salvation, Father.
Yes.
Father, we just ask that you raise up all the mighty warriors as watchmen on the wall, Father, and leading others to Christ. Father, Lord, answer any desperate prayers to those that rely only on you, Father. Lord, strengthen those with a contrite heart and give them a spirit of love, peace, and of a sound mind too, Father. Lord, we proclaim your word to those that would try and hinder your word and your love for all of his children.
Yes, Lord. Yes,
Lord. Lord, yeah, Father, we just ask that you just continue to guide us, Father. Let us decrease that you might increase, Father, because it's not about us, Father. It's about you, Lord.
Yes.
It's about you and what you did on the cross, Father. We ask, Father, that you continue to live in us, to guide us, and to give us the ways of the journey, Father, as we continue this journey, Father. Again, only by your Son, Father, and only as our Lord and our salvation, Father. We thank you, Lord, and we ask this in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Amen. And Father God, we thank you, Lord God, that we are made to sit in heavenly places, that our names are written in the book of life. Hallelujah. And I thank you, Lord, that you said, if ye abide in me and my word abide in you, ye shall ask whatever you will, and it shall be done for you. And those of us, oh God, Lord God, are come before your throne room, Lord God, to be purified by your fire, Father.
Yes.
God, Lord, in the name of Jesus, use us mightily, Lord, in the coming days, oh God, before you return. And Lord, we thank you, Lord God, that this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, we know that you hear us. And we know that if you hear us, we know that we have the petitions that granted that we have desired from you.
Yeah,
so have your way, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, Lord God. And, oh God, have mercy upon those, oh God, that have turned their back on you in this hour, oh God. God, in the name of Jesus, give them still time, Lord God, because tomorrow's not promised to them. But to give them time, Lord God, to repent and to turn from their sins. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, in the name of Jesus Christ. And Lord, we pray, Father God, for miraculous healings of those, oh God, that have been told by doctors that they have so much time to live. Oh God, you have the final word, Lord God.
Yeah, Lord.
To those, the Lord God, that have, Lord God, cancer, oh God, even stage 4 cancer, Lord God, we pray, Father God, for you to miraculously, Lord God, heal them, Lord God. To those that are paralyzed in their bodies, we pray, Father God, Lord God, we speak life to those bodies, Lord, even resurrection life, for your honor and for your glory. Because Lord Jesus, you said, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth on me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And he that liveth and believeth on me shall never die. Father, we pray, Father God, for the revival fires, the fires to come forth, Lord, as never before, Lord God, in every state in this nation, in the name of Jesus, Lord God. Lord, you said, if I be lifted up from the earth, I will draw all men unto me. Thank you for the souls that are going to be coming into the kingdom, oh God, in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for the deliverance, oh God, that will be taking place, Lord God. Lord God, from the crack, from the meth, oh God, in the name of Jesus. From doctrines of demons, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. From the religious spirits, oh God, in the name of Jesus. Oh, we thank you, Lord God, Lord God, for the delivering the homosexuals, oh God, in the name of Jesus, Lord God. Lord, deliver them, oh God, from pornography, oh God, in the name of Jesus. And Lord, we'll just be careful to give you all the praise and the honor and the glory that thou art so worthy of. And everybody say, in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
In the mighty name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
Have your way, Lord God. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. And if you're out there tonight and you prayed with us, go ahead and hit us up on the chat and give us an amen that you was in the prayer with us, standing in the gap with us, because we would like to hear from you. Just go ahead and put on the chats there that you're standing in the gap for all those we prayed for, including Ukraine and including Mexico, including Puerto Rico, including Louisiana. Oh, there's tragedies all over the place. Georgia, Texas. I'm looking on the TV and there's just weather situations going on. And I was just telling my wife earlier, the weather situations just really just got crazy. California, everything, wildfires. You name it, it's happening all over the world. So we have to stand in the gap and stand in prayer, stand with those who are going through, and continue to pray for ourselves, you know, because, you know, it could be us. It could happen to us. You know, we're standing on the outside looking in and turning on the TVs and think, oh my God, you know, and we're so alarmed and so you know, were so taken aback and so shocked about things. But believe me, if you read the Word of God every day, and thank you. This is a pen in the master's hand, Taylor. Yes, thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Good to see you on the air tonight, and we're standing in the gap with you as well. And so, as I was just saying, you know, you turn on the TV and it just doesn't even alarm me anymore. But it really disappoints me in a way that we keep getting hit. You know, just here in the States, in our own backyard, and I care for the people all over the world. But we really have to pray for our own at some point, because we're going through as well. Even when we look like we're doing good, we're still going through. You know, I mean, there's people out there that look like they all good and they look healthy. And you know, and God takes care, like he said in the scriptures, he said, you know, I take care of the birds and the air and the fowl and the creepy things on the water, or, you know, on the earth, and all the fish in the ocean. How much more, you know, the birds don't even know where they're going to sleep at night and where they're going to eat, but how much more do I take care of you? And so when we keep that before us, you know, we don't take for granted, or we don't, you know, take it lightly that we are cared for, but, you know, we have to continue to just be in constant, perpetual prayer. Okay, that's what's going to get us through. And then do something, okay, because, you know, faith without works is dead. All right. And, you know, in this ministry, we're outreach ministry, and we try to pour out. We go out to one of our other evangelists, Evangelist Thomas. I just took a bunch of clothes and different things out to her just a couple of days ago. And so, you know, anywhere that you're in your community, if you got stuff sitting around in your house, you know, somewhere, you know, you need to clean up and do some stuff and don't just clean up to be clearing out your house. You know, really do it in love. Take time to really say, you know, somebody can really use this. You know, don't just dump stuff on people, right? Have some consideration when you give, because that's the main thing about giving. He said, be a cheerful giver, okay? Don't give somebody else just your junk, you know? I mean, I take junk too sometimes, and I can repurpose stuff. I'm good with my hands, you know? I like to build stuff. I like to do things. I can take old junk and turn it into gold, you know? But at the same time, there's people that really have need. You know, that really have needs. So really give, you know, if you got to give some junk, okay, that's fine. But give some good stuff. Give a lot of good stuff too, so that people can really have, you know, an awesome time when they go to these places like Evangelist Thomas. She does it from her home. So when you go down to San Bernardino, you know, to her place, she was out there really working it, guys. I mean, when I pulled up in the truck, she was out there organizing the clothes from the, she said she was organizing the women's clothes, the you know, from the large to the small, you know, and she didn't have a lot of male clothes, but I did bring a lot of male clothes to her, suits and things. She said, oh yeah, I'm gonna give these to the people, you know, to some guys that need to go to church, you know. And so, you know, we just like to be, you know, try to help in any way that we can, food, you know, and hopefully we can start getting some donations in and things like that, where we start doing some, you know, monetary things too. But we don't ask about money on this platform, but there are some giving apps on here. And when we get to our messages and stuff, I'm sure Francis Kirk or, you know, we'll let you guys know how to do that. But, you know, we always just say, God, you know, he's a provider in this ministry. So we don't, you'll never see us asking or seeing cash apps and things of that nature on our site. But we do have a website. You can go to www.joyfellowshipwm.com. And there you'll find we have a giving app. And, you know, and that's the only thing you'll hear, because we want people to be able to be, you know, free. If you're getting fed here, if you like what we're doing, by all means, help out. We're getting ready to start our bookstore. We've been so busy. I just graduated from medical school, and I do a lot of the production stuff here. So it's like really me by myself right now, but I'm teaching all the ministers on platform to be able to come on platform and do what we're doing right here. So pastor don't always have to be here, and I can get to other things that we need to do as far as our virtual bookstore, where people can, and we don't sell the books. You go in the bookstore, and if there's something that you need and you want to donate, by all means, do that as well, because we want to backfill and be able to backfill. So as people take, we can fill it back up. But you know, on there. We usually put a little price on there because the way you sell at the stores, they want you to set something up. So we just kind of give a nominal of what we think it would be worth, you know, but you can donate anything you want to donate, and we will send it out to you. And the donations help us if we have to ship it to you or whatever. That helps us with the cost of shipping books. You know, we haven't started doing it yet, but we're getting ready to fill up the store, and you could go on the Virtual Art channel on Facebook in the marketplace. When you go onto our channel, you go on the Virtual Art channel, and there is, it'll be there that says View Store. Right now, there's nothing in the store, so when you hit that, it's not going to take you anywhere. But promise, we'll have that up in probably in the next 2 weeks. So we're going to be taking pictures of all our books and things so we can get the inventory started. And Minister Adrian is our supply guy. So he's going to be in charge of that store. I'm just setting it up because I'm the tech guy here, so I'm setting it up. But he is our supply sergeant, and so he is providing these books. There's a lot of other things that we're going to be giving away, providing. He's got a coin collection that's out of sight. You know, he's giving me a bunch of coins, giving all of us a bunch of coins, and they're beautiful coins. They're like commemorative coins, and they have some of them have scriptures on them. He gave me a 9/11 coin that's really beautiful. I really cherish that coin because that was a event that I feel like I was part of that because I was in the Guard at the time. But anyway, enough about all of that. We're just glad that everybody is taking notice, and we're just trying to be good stewards and know about, you know, what's going on, and let you guys know how we're progressing around here. And also the last message, just in case we don't get to a break and get all this out, we also have our worship service on every Saturday at 6:00. It's Virtual Art Channel, but it's Joy Fellowship World Ministries, which all of this is up under. Mail Call is our male ministry, is our men's ministry. And Minister Diaz is a drug and alcohol counselor. And we're getting ready to come with a platform called Journey Through Addiction. And that's going to be his platform that we hope to be looking forward to starting that at least by the first of next month. Get that all together. We've been trying to get our technical issues out the way, get things kind of set up. But we have a lot of platforms coming up. So God bless everybody. Just stay on the Virtual Art. Stay on our website, Joy Fellowship World Ministries, or www.joyfellowshipwm.com, and you can keep up with what we're doing, you know, here at the Virtual Art. Back to you guys.
Well, praise God. Thank you so much for that information. Praise God. We're going to take this time to lift our brother. Praise God. Father God, in the name of Jesus, Lord God, we come before you, Lord, with praise and thanksgiving, Lord God, for your servant, for your child, bringing forth your holy word that is able to save souls, the engrafted word of God. For the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of the soul and spirit and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. Father, we thank you, Lord God, right now for Minister Adrian Diaz, Lord God. Let the words of his mouth and the meditation of his heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, for you are his strength and you are his redeemer. Father, continue to pour into him, Lord God, as he brings forth, Lord God, this teaching of your word. In the mighty name of Jesus, we ask this. In the mighty name of Yeshua HaMashiach. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. All righty. Good evening, everybody. Let me ask you two something. When somebody told you that John 14:6, if you want to put that up real fast, when they said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, what did you make of that particular verse? Evangelist Kirk.
To me, when I heard that, there's three things that he said there. I am. Well, no, four, actually. Because I learned that even You know, when Moses had asked the Lord, well, what shall I tell them when I go back into Egypt? And he said, tell them I am that I am. And see, when they came for him in the garden to arrest him, he said, I am. And guess what happened? They fell back. The power of God. They could not withstand the power of God, the words that came out of his mouth. They fell back.
Amen.
See, amen. And the other thing,
amen.
He said, I am the way. See, there is a way which seemeth right unto a man, but the end there are the ways of, you can't do it without Jesus. Jesus said, without me, you can do nothing. And he said, he is the truth. He is the truth. He not only is the truth, but he came with grace and truth. Praise God. I am the way, the truth, and the life. He said, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth on me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. He that liveth and believeth on me shall what? Never die. That's what I thought.
Mm-hmm. Amen, 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 amen. Pastor Youngblood, how about you?
And just to piggyback on what Minister, what Evangelist Kirk said, you know, when you break it down, I mean, it's right there in your face, basically, you know. There's no other way but Jesus, okay? You know, a lot of people say, well, I'm living this life, I'm doing this, I'm doing that. But when it all comes down to it, he is the way. He is the way, okay? Because we can't even operate, get up with our faculties. We can't get up. We can't think. We can't move. We can't, you know, we can't even come up with a good excuse of why we do what we do other than Jesus. You know, God created us, but see, God is the Godhead. There's three in one, right? He said it's the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. So with all three of those, you know, I mean, it's a combination. You can't have one without the other. And then he says the truth. Well, you know, we try to, that's our motto right here, truth and transparency. You know, if we're not giving the truth and speaking the truth, and that's speaking Jesus, you know, anything that he says is the truth that we're putting out. Today I got a bunch of, you know, Facebook loaded. They gave us like $30 of credit to go around, and it happened to be mail call. It's, you know, how we post and boost the apps. But I got all kind of hate mail. I mean, I just happened to check it out. You know, they send you notices. And oh my goodness, you know, the one guy was using all this language, but he was saying, you know, what? Because it says, is there anything that we can do to help you? And then the comment back was, you could help me just by shutting the, you know, F up and getting rid of your religion and dropping your religion. I mean, there was a bunch of comments like that. And then there were some good comments. One guy left a big, long comment, and I'll share that probably after with you guys when we get off the air. But just, there's so much hate. And, you know, we're trying to spread gospel and truth. And Satan got his imps and his people that he got. And there's always a spiritual warfare. This is what we've been trying to teach, you know, for the last few months about spiritual warfare. And so when we're in the spirit and we got Jesus, he's true. But people don't want to hear it. You know, they don't want to hear it. They denied Jesus when he came here. And they're still denying him after he left, right? And then he says, I'm the life. Well, he I don't know no other guy that took the beatings, died, got buried, and rose up with all power in his hand. Right? I don't know any other God that we hear of that did all of that, that even wrote about that kind of stuff happening, right? No other God, you know, that you could go to the Buddhas and the Torahs. I mean, not the Torah, but you could go to the Buddhas and go to the Hare Krishnas and the Baha'i, you know, all whatever they worship. You know, if it's not worshiping God and Jesus Christ, you ain't never heard about no other gods being able to be to take that beating, to die, bury, and then rise up. Mm-mm. And then he says, no man has access to the Father but by me or through me.
Amen.
And so, okay, if that's what I got to do, it's just like a one-way road. I can only go one way. If I got some car coming at me the wrong way, if he coming the opposite way, then, you know, that's a fight. That's what we used to call chicken. Who's going to jump out the way, right? And so I'm not going to be chicken. I'm going to stand my ground, okay? And I'm going to be like Ruth or any of them or Esther. You know, if this is what's got to happen, that's what's got to happen, right? If it's unto death, then that's what I'm going, you know, I'm going to have to do. I'm going to have to just roll with it and suffer whatever, you know, the consequence, because Christ did it for us. So, you know, and that's basically, that's it. That, to me, that's in a nutshell for me, is that what he says is true. What he says is the life. And what he says, you can't have access to anything that comes through him. You got to go through him to get anything that's good, you know, that you want. You got to go through him. So there you go.
Well, great, great. Yeah, I want to look at this scripture. This, you know, there's a lot of people that are familiar with this scripture, but there's a lot of people that aren't. And I want to put up John 3:16 and 17. And then Evangelist Kirk, if you could read the NLT for me.
Sure.
So John 3:16 and 17. Mm-hmm. Now, a lot of people know this. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life.
Mm-hmm. In the NLT, it says, for God loved the world so much that he gave his one and only Son, so that everyone who believes in him will not perish, but have eternal life.
And then 17 says, 3:17, it says, for God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved.
And out of the NLT, God sent his Son into the world not to judge the world, but to save the world through him.
Now, when you look at these two verses, you know, that's also telling everybody that the only way for this peace to happen is through Jesus. If people don't get this, then they're either not listening right or reading right, or they just don't care, you know. And going back to, you know, the people that left your comment at work that were real negative, you know, the sad part is when they wake up after this life, they're gonna say, man, I wish I would have listened, or something like that. I mean, mm-hmm. I'm sure it's gonna be a little more dramatic than that, but the thing is, you know, everybody's familiar with those scriptures, you know. A lot of people are, I guess. But perhaps there are not many who truly understand the real meaning, you know. John 14:6, you know, being I am the way, the truth, and life, and nobody comes to the Father but through me. You know, a lot of times you ask people, what does that scripture really mean to you? And, you know, what does the Lord want us to understand by saying these words? Well, obviously, what the scripture means is that Jesus is the only way. Jesus is the only life, and Jesus, you know, he is the truth. He's the way, he's the life. You know, in a nutshell, it's Jesus. Nobody, no name above any name is only Jesus. He is the only way to salvation and truth. And people are just not getting it, I guess. You know, mm-hmm. That's the sad part, because,
that's right.
You know, a lot of times, yeah. But this is the whole thing, you know. It says, in order to understand what I am the way, the truth, and the life means, which Jesus spoke, it's important to be clear that only God can express the truth, grant people life, and show us the way. Before the Lord Jesus saw, he himself was the truth. No person had said he himself was the truth, and no person could express that truth. No person. Only the incarnate Lord Jesus said that he was the truth, and more importantly, he could express the truth. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, full of grace and truth. Now check that one out. You know, the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. You know, in the beginning of the book of John, where it says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God. Well, the Word they're talking about is Jesus. Jesus is the God. Jesus is the Word. He came incarnate to show the people and to help the people. I mean, you can't have it. You can't have it any better than that.
Amen. So,
you know, we must remember, was God incarnate? That is, God's Spirit clothed Himself in the flesh as the Son of Man to work in the human world. Jesus possessed the divine essence. And this was how the Lord Jesus could express, you know, God's disposition and what God has and is, and could express the truth and perform the work of saving mankind based on their needs. You know, which was pretty much everything. You know, we have to solely rely on Christ for everything. No matter what it is, we have to solely rely on God. We have to give it to Him. No matter what it is,
amen.
Even if it takes us a long time for any answered prayer, because God's timing is always going to be perfect. We may not think so, but His timing is always going to be perfect.
yes.
You know,
yeah. Yeah. It's something which nothing else in all of creation is capable of. So you know that in a nutshell is, I mean. How much in big letters can you not see the big letters? What is it saying? Jesus, the only way, the truth, and the life through Jesus. So you know, breaking down this most important scripture verse, we'll see why it is so important to know why Jesus is truly the way, the truth, and the life. So in with the first part, it says Jesus said unto him, I am the way. Well, you know, you see Jesus takes the opportunity to tell us about the place he was going to and the way unto it. He more importantly instructed his disciples concerning himself, saying, I am the way. Christ is not merely the way as he goes before the people as an example, or merely as a prophet. He was pointing out unto them by this doctrine the only way to salvation. But he is the way of salvation itself. By this obedience and sacrifice, nor is there any other way. He is the way of his Father's appointing, which is entirely agreeable to the perfections of God and suitable to the condition of the sinner. You know, God is the only one who can forgive us of our sins, no matter what they are. And if you truly are meaning it in your heart, when you come before the Lord, if you truly are meaning in your heart, He'll know. And if you truly mean in your heart, you're going to be forgiven. And your sin is cast in the sea of forgetfulness, never to be remembered again, not even by God. He stands on His promises. So, you know, He is the way to all blessings.
Amen.
Of the covenant. Of Amen. Grace, of grace. And He is the right way into the gospel church state, here in which no one can enter into the kingdom but by the faith of Jesus Christ. You know, He is the way to heaven by His own bloodshed, and He has opened the way for us to follow Him. How much simpler can it be? How much simpler can it be that Jesus is the way to salvation? Jesus is the way that we'll be able to go down that narrow road that leads to heaven.
Yes.
I mean, how plain and clear, how plain and clear can it be? I mean, you know, it's like in bold letters, Jesus, Jesus, you know, you see that light, that sign says Jesus is the only way. Jesus is the only way. And yet, a lot of people are rejecting that. A lot of people don't want to walk with Christ. They want what the world has. And all that, and as the word says, pretty much, pretty soon, you know, God's gonna hand them over to a reprobate mind, and you know, they won't know anything right in a sense until they stand before God. And when they're told, you know, depart from me, you worker of iniquity, for I never knew you, how much screaming is going to be? How much gnashing of teeth is there going to be? I mean, oh my gosh, I can't even think of anything like that. But God's justice will be, God will not be mocked. You know, God will not allow sin and you know, and all that. And so all those, so many people that are actually going to hell,
right?
It can be a frightening thing. You know, so when you hear, you know, Jesus being the only way, and if you break it down, that should tell you initially that Jesus is the only way. So my question to you is, when you first got saved and somebody told you, I am the way, the truth, and life, but we're gonna just park it on I am the way first, were you initially caught off guard? Were you initially, you know, Jesus is the only way? Or, I mean, maybe you can answer that for me, Evangelist Kirk.
I am the way. There's no other way. There is no other way. Once you learn that there is no other way and you try to do it on your own, you become very unsuccessful.
Right.
And what's happening is you're entertaining the wrong spirit in your life. You're giving into seducing spirits to turn you away from the true God.
Right.
Not an idol. See, we serve a God that can hear 24/7.
Right.
We serve a God that can see 24/7. He has hands that can take care of situations. He walks. The eyes of the Lord are in every place, beholding what? The evil and the good. If you think there's no God in heaven, you got another thing coming.
Yeah, absolutely.
Amen.
So Pastor Youngblood, how about you? When you were first saved and somebody spoke to you on, John 14:6, what was your initial reaction?
Well, I would just say that, you know, my reaction was the same, like I said earlier, that, you know, once I knew who Jesus was, there was no question in my mind that he was the true God, that he was the creator, you know, even though we're speaking of Jesus in the tense, sure, of you know, being, yeah, part of the Godhead. You know, that whole Trinity or three in one, because you won't find the Trinity in the Bible, but
no.
Three in one is the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. And as I said before, you know, God being the Godhead, the Son being below that, and then, you know, and then the Spirit, but they work all together. And once I, you know, when I got saved, you started hearing all these miraculous scriptures, because, you know, people were saying them in church all the time, you know. You know, he is the truth, the way, and the life, you know. A funny story, on my notebook, when I was in elementary, I had this blue material binder that I had, like a three-ring binder, and I keep all my schoolwork and stuff in there. And, you know, I was even coming through school and junior high and all of this, I was believing in God, you know, I was sold out. And I put on there, you know, because I wasn't reading, you know, I was young. I wasn't reading the scriptures like I should have, you know, I guess. But at the same time, they were, you know, that some of that was resonating in me, but I heard it wrong. I'm thinking that the pastors or the ministers, wherever I might have heard it from, said that Jesus was the way, the truth, and the light, which he is. But then my mother corrected me when she saw me write this on the front of my binder, because I was carrying it with me. You know, I'm advocating as a young kid this scripture, which I thought was right. But she said, no, son, that's not the right scripture. That's not the way that scripture reads. It's life, not light. But, you know, I just heard what I heard, you know. And she said, but, you know.
Well, he is the light.
Yeah. He is the light. So there was no wrong.
He's the light of the world.
Absolutely. So there was no wrong, nothing wrong about it, as being, especially being a child. But now as a young man, you know, as an old man now, you know, I would never try to get, you know, confuse that. You know, you got to read the scriptures rightly, you know, and divide them rightly. But that's just, you know, my take on it was I was sold out on that scripture at a young age. And you just brought that back to memory to me. You know, that's amazing. And the last thing I would say, I found my mother had a cross here that I had brought upstairs. I was taking some things out and trying to clean up around here. And she has like a ceramic cross that hangs on the wall with that very same scripture that I had today.
Wow.
So this was really a time. This was a good lesson coming up. This had significance about us bringing that up today, you know, bringing this scripture up today. And that just,
Well, think about it. Hold on one second, Evangelist Kirk. Hold on one second. Think about it. You know, you have two lines of people, and one cave has the light in it, and mm-hmm. one cave is dark. All the people that are rejecting Christ are walking into that dark tunnel. Mm-hmm. All the people that are accepting of Christ are walking into the tunnel with light.
Right.
I mean, it says it's plain in your sight. It's plain in your heart.
Mm-hmm.
The light. You know, a city cannot be hid. You know, on the hill that has a light. You know.
Right.
So
that's right.
If you think about it, why? Because it's so simple. Why are people going down the darkness? Evangelist Kirk, go ahead. You had something.
Oh, I definitely have something, and the Lord brought it to me while I was listening to you. Praise God. You know, when I was little, well, actually, I was a teenager, and I was raised by my grandmother, and I had two uncles living in the house with me. And praise God, one of my uncles, he took up a lot of time with me, you know, because I didn't have a father. And my other uncle, I loved him, but he was, you know, he was into his career and what have you, you know, and plus he was a police officer. Anyway, to make a long story short, my uncle, he got into a lot of trouble all the time, and he had been in jail, and he said he'd rather take a beating than to go to jail, you know. And by him running with the wrong crowd, because, I mean, he was basically God, you know, was grooming him to be a leader. But he chose to go the wrong way, see. So he got with these guys one night. They decided that they were going to break into this restaurant, okay? And the man lived upstairs, the owner, okay? And so when they broke in, the man was sitting up on the stairway with a 12-gauge shotgun. And he just got my uncle, okay? My bedroom was on the back porch, you know, and it was during the time when it was nice outside and the windows were, you know, the screens were on the windows and what have you. At 3 o'clock in the morning is God's hour that I learned later on in life. But I heard my grandmother's room was right next to the front door. And I heard her get up because the phone had rang. But before the phone rang, the Lord showed me something. I woke up and I literally saw stars on my ceiling. This is the honest to God truth. And I was wondering what the heck was I seeing. The next thing I know, the phone rang. And I heard my grandmother get up and she went and picked up the phone. And next thing, there was silence. And the next thing was a deep, deep moan, grown. See, from her son, my uncle, being shot. So I heard my other uncle next to me and next to my room, and he was scurrying around and what have you. And I said, "What's going on?" He said, "Frank's been shot." I said, "What?" "Yeah, we're going to the hospital." I said, "Can I go?" "No, you have to stay home." So, you know, I began to pray and whatever, because I was always a praying. You know, when I learned how to pray, I've been praying ever since. Okay.
Did he live?
Well, let me tell you. Here's what happened. So he went, my uncle and my grandmother, they went to the hospital and what have you. They came back, and I asked my uncle, I said, "How's he doing?" And he was quiet there for a minute, and he said, "Frank passed away." I said, "What?" And I said, "Did he say anything before he died?" He said, "Yes. I see you, Jesus. Have mercy upon me." See, it's appointed unto man to die. After that, the judgment is what the word of God tells us. So he literally saw Jesus. And from that point on, because he said that, well, later on, the Lord showed me that he's with him.
Right.
See, you don't want to wait till you die.
No, you might not get that chance.
Exactly.
Yeah. As they said, now is the appointed time to be saved.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You know, what I think is your uncle probably knew he was on his way out, for lack of a better term. And maybe he got fearful, and right there in his heart, and I'm sure he totally meant it when he said, you know, for Jesus.
I forgot to mention something. He was living downstairs, okay, at the time. And he came upstairs and he said, "Mom, I had this dream." It was on a Sunday morning. I was sitting next to the radiator on the wall, and I had sprawled myself out on the dining room floor and was reading the biblical comics. And when he came out and said that, so I heard my grandma say, "Oh, Frank, what was the dream that you had?" So he said, "I dreamed I died by fire."
Wow.
Oh, wow.
And it was not too long afterwards when he died.
But he went home with the Lord, that's for sure.
Yeah. Yeah, well, see, he found his wife in a holiness church, and he started going to that holiness church, and he'd come home and tell mom about it, you know, my grandmother. And she said, "Frank, don't mock the Lord like that. Don't mock those people, because they love the Lord." See, and later on, I found his Bible, and I found his Bible underline about the Holy Spirit.
Yeah. I'll be darned. You know, I tell you, you know, oh my gosh, that's why it's so plain to see and so simple. I mean, you're going to keep on saying it, Jesus being the only way, the truth, and the life. And Jesus showing up, or your uncle seeing Jesus, and then confessed his faults and repented and asked for forgiveness. And I'm sure Jesus said, "You'll be with me for eternity."
Mm-hmm.
I mean, how much more plain do you have to see something? Okay. This is where the faith comes in. You can't quote unquote see, you know, your eternity or anything like that. But if you have the faith, which is faith is the substance of the things hoped for, the evidence of things not yet seen. That's where your faith comes in. And if you have that faith inside your heart, again, you can make a mountain move. But that faith is what draws you closer to God, and vice versa. You know, God draws nearer to you because you have that faith. But on the second part of that verse, where it says, you know, first one was, "I am the way, The second one says, I am the truth. You know, the truth. You remember in the Bible, I think it's in John, but where it says, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free.
Amen.
Well, the truth being Jesus Christ. I always thought in that one scripture, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. I thought it was, you know, if I admitted to myself that you know, I'm a sinner and I've done all this kind of stuff. Well, no, that's not all of it. You know Jesus, knowing that he's going to forgive you of your sins if you confess it and believe it in your heart. That's where the truth, you know the truth, which is Christ, and Jesus will set you free with breaking all the chains of everything that had you in bondage. You know? Now, you know, Jesus is not only truth, but, you know, truth itself. You know, we regard his person and his character. He is the true God. As a prophet, he taught the way of God and truth, the faithful and the merciful one, and as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Now, all his ways are just and true. So when I say that all his ways are just and true, that says what he's saying. All his ways are just and true. No other way. All of his ways are just and true. You know, he is the son, he is the sum and the substance of all truths of the gospel. Okay? They're all full in them of who Jesus is. Every one of those gospels. And then they center on him. Only Jesus they center on. He's the truth of all the types and shadows, all the promises and prophecies of the Old Testament, all of his accomplishments as the true and only way. You know, he was the opposition to all of the false ones of man's devising a lot of the, you know, a lot of the Jews opposed him by saying there is no truth but the law. And we've gone over that already about we are dead to sin through the Ten Commandments. But when Jesus came, all that changed again.
Mm-hmm.
And so anyways, right before we take a break, I want to finish this there. It says you know, we know they didn't speak the truth. And Jesus is the true living God and King. And so when you look at it like that, how much plainer can it be right in front of you? I mean, how much more plain? People, they just turn their back. I don't get it. You know, I really don't get it. But anyways, we'll continue this after break.
Amen. Well, we've got a great song for you tonight. It's by C.C. Winans. Mercy Said No. Hope you guys enjoy this song. And we'll come back with probably some announcements. And then we'll get back into our story and our lesson of with Minister Diaz, the way, the truth, and the life. All right. And then go ahead and enjoy.
I have spent my days believing that what it have me be is who I am. As I've come to see the weaker side of me, I've realized His grace is what I'll need. When sin demanded justice for my soul, mercy said no, I'm not gonna let you go. I'm not gonna let you slip away. You don't have to be afraid. Mercy said no, sin will never take control. Life and death stood face to face. Darkness tried to steal my heart away. Thank you, Jesus. Mercy said no. From the cross He built a bridge to set us free. Oh, but deep within our hearts, there is still a war that rages and makes a sacrifice so hard to see. As midnight fell on crucifixion day, the as evil tried to stop redemption's flow, mercy said no.
Mercy said no. Wow, wow, wow. You know, when everything else points to that type of situation, mercy steps in and says, no, you can't have him. You can't have her. You can't do the things you want to do. You know, and so, and I always talk about those two twins, grace and mercy. You know, those are the two twins that we got in our favor, grace and mercy.
Amen.
And so, I mean, that's an awesome song by CC Winans. And I think we should take that to, you know, take heart to that, that mercy can stand in the way, stand, you know, come in and stand in the gap for us, as we're praying about today, standing in the gap for those who need mercy, those who need favor, those who need grace. Mm-hmm. And so we can all get that. But a lot of times some people are a little more shorter, a little more broken than us. They need a little more favor, a little more grace, a little more mercy. So thank God for that. Thank God for that.
Absolutely. Yes. Hallelujah. He gives mercy unto 1,000 generations that love him and keep his holy commandments. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Praise God. We've been talking about I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man can come unto the Father except through who?
Jesus. Christ.
Jesus Christ. God made it possible for us to come unto the Father through who? Mm-hmm. Through Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, praise God. We thank God for this broadcast. We thank God for this teaching. And now we're going to return to this teaching. Minister, praise God, Adrian Diaz.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. I hope and pray that anybody that's out there listening to this message, that it really pricks your heart into realizing that there is no other way, no other way but Jesus. And that if you're going through something like that, just rely on Jesus. Because the second part of that scripture verse, it says, Jesus saith, I am the life, or the third part, excuse me. I am the way, the truth, and the life. Now, you know, Christ is the author and giver of life. Okay. And naturally, spiritually, and eternally, is the way of life, the living way. In opposition to the law, which was so far from being the way of life, the law was administration of condemnation and death. That's all the law was. We couldn't keep the commandments. We were always sinning, you know. You know, Jesus is always and will ever be the only way. And with Jesus, we'll live eternally and never die. And it's this way that leads to the eternal life. You know, Christ is the true way. I mean, you know, one scripture that I like, you don't have to put it up, but it's John 15:13, and where it says, you know, greater love no man have than this, that he would lay down his life for his friend. What did Jesus do at the cross? He laid down his life for all of mankind. I mean, gosh, if that doesn't make you think about, you know, maybe I ought to try this Jesus. You know, maybe I really ought to get real. Maybe I ought to, you know, confess it in my heart or receive in my heart that, you know, Jesus is the only way. You know, and God will surely, you know, accommodate them. Because he says, if you go searching for me, you'll find me.
Right.
So, and that saying, I mean, again, I mean, how simple. Why, you know, my question is, why are there people who are so, I hate saying it like this, who are so stuck on stupid and just don't care? You know, because, you know, they're procrastinating or whatever the case is, that they don't believe in the God. Or if they really believe, then they know that there's literally a hell, just like there's a heaven, and that they have to get right. And many of them are living in the darkness. And again, they just don't seem to care. So my question is, why are these people doing that, Evangelist Kirk?
Well, because they think they're in control of their life.
Yeah.
You know, what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and to lose his own soul? And you've got people that are wealthy, you know, money will buy anything they want. See, they have yachts, you see. And even with this going on with the Ukraine and going on with Russia and the sanctions and that have been removed and what have you, even the oligarchs, I think I'm pronouncing that right, these are wealthy Russians. And now their yachts are seized, their bank accounts and everything else. See, God has a way of blowing on what you have, and you don't have nothing. So what does it profit a man to gain the whole world to lose his own soul? And what can a man give in exchange for his soul?
Just accepting Christ.
See? He that believeth on him is not condemned. He that believeth not is condemned already, because he what? Because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. It's just that simple.
Very simple, yes.
You've tried everything else. You know? You've tried all these women. You've been a pimp. You got stables. You got all these places that are, you know, like a front for your behavior. But do you have peace?
No.
You're going to pay dues for what you're doing. And you're going to reap what you sow.
Yep. Yeah.
See,
you can't take anything with you.
And the whole thing in a nutshell is, pleasure's only for a season. It ain't going to last. You might think it is. You might think you on the top of the world, and you so in control, and all of a sudden an earthquake happens, and you lose everything. All of a sudden, you're in a tornado. You're going down the street in your fabulous ride. You're blown off a bridge. Do you know where you're going? Do you know where you're going if missile hits the United States of America? You in control then? Tomorrow's to you. And all this pride and all this arrogance and thinking you all this and all that, and you ain't nothing.
Nothing.
Without God.
Right. Wow. How about you there, Pastor Youngblood?
Well, I'll just say these couple of passages I found. First one is in Deuteronomy 7 and 9. And he says, "Know therefore that the Lord thy God, he is God, and the faithful God, which keepeth covenant and mercy." We just talked about that song, mercy. "With them that love him and keep his commandments to 1,000 generations.
Yeah.
Think about that, 1,000 generations. We're going past and past and past and past and past. And there's a such thing that we call generational curses.
Yes.
Well, we got to start breaking some of these generational curses that continue to basically jump in and make a mess, to allow people not to make amends with one another, family members, angry about something they heard, you know, that they wasn't even here when something like that happened, right? And so these are the things that we would call generational curses that just seem to proceed. The person that committed those deeds, long gone, in the grave, in the ground, and they still are prevalent today. Those, you know, well, my mama, you said something to my mama about that, and then that perpetrates, and then it goes on and goes on. We got to break those curses. Then the other one is, he will hold you. Hebrews 7:25 says, "Where he is able also to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him, seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them. God's going to be here forever and ever to hold us up, whatever, you know, whatever we're doing. But it's our job to commit to what he wants us to do and what his word says. If we're not obedient and doing the things of God, then we're out of order. And God can't work with that. He cannot work with that. You got to come to him boldly. You got to be totally broken down that he can live in you, that you can be totally sold out for him, that you can be a broken vessel for him. You can be, he's a potter and we're the clay. And he needs to be able to mold us into what he has called us to be. He's already called us to be something.
Yes.
But now we've got to be molded into that, okay? We're already born into it. But the word says we're also been shaped into iniquity. Now we got to let God reshape us into holiness.
Yeah. Oh, glory, 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 glory.
Can I say that again? Ooh. We need to get out of being shaped into iniquity. Ooh,
praise
and
God.
And be reshaped into glory, into righteousness. Mm. That's the only way that we can make it in. That's the only way that we can live and know that we're really serving the true and living God. And my last, I got one more. And then he will abide with us. John 15 and 5 says, I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me, ye can do nothing. Just as the evangelist said, we are nothing without him. We are nothing without him. We are like dung in his nose. Nothing.
Yes.
Okay, and then the last one I'll say, binds his words and promises in you. Okay, Proverbs 3:1-4. It says, my son, forget not my law, his law, not the law we've been talking about on the other broadcasts, on our worship services that we've been teaching Romans, but his law, but let thine heart keep my commandments. I'm talking about obedience here. That's what I opened up with. We got to be obedient. And he says, for length of days and long life and peace, where we've been talking about peace, right? Shall they add to thee? Let not mercy, hear that word again, and truth, there's that other word, forsake thee. Bind them about thy neck. Write them upon the tablets of thy heart.
Yes.
So thy shall find favor and good understanding in the sight of God and man. Powerful.
Yes, it is.
Amazing. Well, I'm going to close up with this. You know, the last part of that verse is, no man cometh unto the Father but by me, or through me. You know, Christ is the only access to God. Plain and simple, the only access to God. No other way. Like your Oprah Winfrey said, there's many ways to God. She calls herself a Christian. Oh, I'm a Christian. I don't think you really know what you're talking about, Oprah Winfrey. You know, but you know, he's the only access to God, our Father, you know, our Creator. And you cannot get to the Father through your works.
Nope.
We can't merit our way into heaven.
Nope.
Nor without a mediator, which is Christ. He'll introduce and present the people and services of his people to his Father.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when he does that, we know that our names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Because they're going to be read. Your name is going to be read out of that book. Obviously, and if your name is in that book, guess what? You're going straight into heaven. And lo and behold, all the people that ever rejected him or turned their backs on him or whatever, when they hear, I'm sorry, your name's not in the Lamb's Book of Life, so, you know, depart from me. And they go straight to hell. I mean, oh my gosh, I can't even imagine that. You know, like I said, we're accepted into the kingdom of heaven, you know. And as Evangelist Kirk said, I mean, how much more simple you need it in writing. I mean, you could paste it on your forehead. The only way to heaven is through Christ Jesus to the Father. I mean, that's simple. And yet, people still reject it. People mm-hmm. still walk in darkness. People still don't care. I don't know. I just, you know, I'm just like, and can you imagine how Jesus feels because people are rejecting him? You know, remember in the Bible, the shortest verse was,
Jesus wept. Yeah.
Yeah. That, I just don't get it. I don't get it. But anyways, I think it was a pretty good breakdown of that particular verse, because people need to understand the reasons for Jesus being the way, the truth, and the life, and not getting to the Father but through him. Mm-hmm. So when you break it all down, you realize just how important Jesus is to your eternity. So very important. And right there, you know, I mean, totally believe in your heart, confess it with your mouth, and there you go, you're sealed unto redemption and stuff. Mm-hmm. So I want to thank Evangelist Kirk and Pastor Youngblood. I pray that anybody out there that was listening and following this particular message, this teaching, you know, got some seed planted, or got to the point where they were so emotionally consumed because they know they need Christ, that God will do his works in you, and you can start walking with Christ now. Anyways, I'm going to turn it back over to you, Evangelist Kirk, and I just want to thank you again.
Amen.
Amen, and I thank you so much for that powerful teaching. Praise God. And I pray that our listeners really got something out of it. Praise God, that will carry them through the rest of this week, and praise God, and make up their mind, praise God, to have a mindset to really have a relationship with our Father, his Son, Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. And, you know, we never close mail call without having an altar call. Praise God, because we don't assume that everyone on this line is saved. So with that said, I'm calling on you again, Minister Diaz, to bring that invitation.
Amen, amen, and amen. You know, I know there's people out there that feel like they've been forgotten about. I know there's people out there that are homeless, living in poverty, living in sin, although in their heart, you know, they want to walk straight and narrow. People that are hurting, just so many things of why why there's a void in your life. And the only way for that void to be filled is, you know, is through Jesus Christ. You know, if you really think about what he did on the cross, you're going to understand why he did it for you. He loves us so much that he followed through with what his Father knew what he was going to do. He got beat. He even said while he's getting beat, you know, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. I mean, just everything. And then when he was up on the cross, the thief that was on his right side said, you know, this man didn't do anything, but Jesus, take me with you when you go. And Jesus said, from this point forward, you'll be with me in paradise. He was accepted. I mean, think about it. So I'm going to tell you this. If you truly, truly, your heart's been affected and pricked into wanting something better and following Christ, you know, the way, the truth, and the life, then all you need to do is open up your mouth and believe it in your heart, totally believe it in your heart. Just say these words: Jesus, I am a sinner.
Jesus, I am a sinner. Jesus,
I am a sinner.
And Lord, I need help.
And Lord, I need help, Father.
Lord, I need help, Father.
Yes, and Lord, I am ready to turn my life over to you.
Lord, Lord, I am ready to turn my life over to you.
Lord, I repent of all my sins, past, present, and future.
Lord, I repent of all my sins, past, present, and future.
And I turn to you, Jesus, and take you into my life as my Lord and Savior.
And I turn to you, Jesus.
And I take you into my life. To be with you.
As my Lord and Savior. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Praise God. Hallelujah. Welcome into the kingdom of God.
Yes.
And as of this moment, the kingdom of God is within you. But as many as received him, to them gave he power. Who gave power? Jesus gives you power to become sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. You've made the best decision you could ever make in life.
Yes.
And you will have everlasting life with God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And no man is able to pluck you out of my Father's hands, is what the Lord says, because I and my Father are one.
Hallelujah. Amen. Well, if you accepted Jesus Christ again, we congratulate you for making that choice, that step, because it was an important step for you to take. Your life is about to change.
Yes.
Your life is really going to change, and it's not going to be overnight. It's not going to be overnight, but as they say, wait for it. Wait for it. Be patient.
Yep.
And God, you're going to see some things over the next course of your weeks to come, your months to come, that you're going to say, wow, I made the right choice, because had I not made that choice, certain situations you might look at and say, that something else would have happened. I know what it would have happened, but because I did what I did last week or whatever, however it's going to be, long it's going to be, when you were on this broadcast and you accepted Christ Jesus. And I also want to encourage you to write this date down. Today is the 5th? Put that somewhere that you can know the exact day that you was, you know, that you accepted Christ in your life. Then you can monitor how long, you know, what God has been doing in your life from this day forward. And so, you know, these are the important dates, just like your birthday, your child's birthday, your mama's birthday. This is your rebirth date. This is the date that you've been reborn, reshaped, renewed, revived, restored. And we congratulate you. Stick around here if you need any assistance. I think we made the announcements, but you can reach out to us at www.joyfellowshipwm.com. That's our website. We're here every Thursday night on this platform at Mail Call. Every Thursday night at 7:00, come on and just continue to learn about Christ Jesus. And also, if you're not attending church and you want to find a church, well, you found it. Joy Fellowship World Ministry is our church. And we come on at Saturdays, the Sabbath day, every Saturday at 6:00, right here. And we're teaching right now the book of Romans. So if you want to really learn the Bible and really take it piece by piece, that's what we're doing with this book of Romans. And we're going to go through the whole and entire Bible, hopefully, at some point, however God leads. But right now we're doing that whole chapter. And it's so good. Everybody takes a little piece and teaches it. And everybody that's on the platform is part of that. And we have other people that are part of that are partnering up with us. I think you will really enjoy it. If you know somebody else that needs to be saved or somebody that needs to hear the word of God, truth and transparency and understanding where the kids, we put the cookies down where the kids can reach them, as my daddy would say. Yeah, I ain't going to challenge you tonight, Evangelist. but that's one of our models. That is one of our main models. My dad started this ministry, and I took the ministry. God gave me the ministry. He called me to the pastorate. And so now I'm pastoring, and this is a 40-year-old ministry, plus 40-year-plus ministry. We started in 1977. So don't get it wrong. We've been here for a while. You know, we just now getting on the platforms and things like that. You probably haven't heard about us, but this ministry has been established since 1977. So we have been teaching the Gospels for that long. And so we encourage you that we're a full-fledged church. You got a lot of ministers and ministries out there that they're not incorporated. They're running rogue. And you want to be somewhere that you know that there's safety, that you can be sure that we have been taught. We teach the truth and transparency, and we are a full-fledged church. So if you want to, you need somebody to help bury a person, or you need to be married and you want services, you need somebody to pray for you, to go to the hospital, whatever it might be, reach out to us to see what we can do for you if you're close enough. And if you're not close enough, we have other partners. That's what's so good about this, is that we have people all over the world that we could reach out to and get some call, get some help to you. So This is it. This is the hotline. So, amen. Hotline for Christ.
Well, right now, praise God, I want to pray for those that gave their life to Christ tonight. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, oh, Lord, strengthen them in every fiber of their being, oh, God.
Yeah, Lord.
And, Lord, I ask, Lord God, you said, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled.
Yes.
Fill them with your spirit and cause them to get excited, Lord God. Mm. Give them a sweet sleep, Lord. When they lay down, they will not be afraid. And they will wake up in the morning rejoicing in the new life of Christ.
Yes.
In Jesus' name. And bless them going out and coming in. Keep them as the apple of your eye. Watch over them. Protect them from all hurt, harm, and danger.
Yes.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. And cause his face to shine upon you.
Amen.
I'm Brother Rich, and we love you. We love you here on Mail Call. I'm Brother Rich, and this has been called Mail Call.
Amen. All righty.
Family of love.
Amen.